to the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd like to announce that tonight's meeting will both be video and audio taped. If anybody in the audience is doing so, please inform the board at this time. Mr. Burrell, Elaine, both video and audio?
Aye.
Video and audio, Mr.
Yep.
Burrell.
Thank you.
Meeting minutes. Mr. Gagner.
Make a motion to approve the minutes of September 22nd, 2015, as written.
Second. A motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Old business. You're first on the list, we'll go with Igor. You're up, sir, regarding Warren Public Access Channel 12, discussion on expansion of services regarding meetings.
Well, I submitted all the programming needs that you were asking for, and I hope you have a copy of the breakdown and a cost. And this is on an average or bare minimum, so to speak. And there's some boards or departments that I couldn't get in touch. So the budget that you got right now for a whole year, it probably will go up instead of go down. If we do like say a cultural council, any kind of meetings, or if there's gonna the capital planning goes, or you know, CERT meeting or something like that, if it comes up, and any extra special things. I did not include any cost for whatever we're doing up to now. Board of Selectmen meetings and school committee meetings, I didn't put in there because we already committed to that, and I was on that there. And just to that budget, how much will be cost for the whole year, I just want to add to it that it's your decision. But in any case, anytime any department head or secretary contacted us and it said, we got something really important for the taxpayers of town of Warren, we have a meeting or discussion. As long as they give us a week in advance notice or 2 weeks in advance notice, we always oblige, and I would say 99.9% we always did those meetings. So, but you requested it to break down of all the boards, and so I submitted to you finally on that. So there it is.
So the total line here, Igor, is $24,068.75, correct?
Correct.
Is that in addition to what you do now?
Yes.
That is an addition to.
Yes.
Do you have anything, Jim?
No. Igor, you have been incredibly accommodating anytime any of the boards ask for you to come out. I just wanted to see what it would take to get everything covered, get as much transparency out there as possible, people who can't make the meetings, and see what the cost would be associated to that. So I appreciate all the work you've done.
And one more thing, may I say something to through is that it's very hard to get any older people, volunteers, so to speak, 18 and over. We're depending on the high school students. And just for this, to broadcast all those meetings that are included, plus whatever we're doing, I cannot really say 100% that I'm going to have them for every meeting, because the school will come in first for them. Some of them even got an outside job, so I cannot guarantee the staffing for every meeting. That's another thing.
Well, I appreciate your work on this. I don't necessarily think that we need to videotape or audiotape every single meeting. I mean, there's some important meetings that do come up throughout the year that we may consider wanting to do, but at a cost of $24,000 in additional fees to do everything, it's extremely high for us right now. Beverly, have a question?
Yeah, back in May at these town meeting, there was a citizen's petition to televise some of the committees, and basically it was just the finance, capital planning, and planning board of directors. Now, just those meetings, those particular meetings, would that be over 20,000?
He has it broken down in here based on different committees and boards.
Yeah, so what if we just did the...
We could. I mean, there's a possibility we'll do that. Like I stated, you know, we can do certain meetings. We don't have to do them all. So that is a possibility, I think.
We're doing sorry. We're doing right now the planning board. It's they ask us, there's going to be a third meeting they ask us to do. We're doing one tomorrow about the opening up the town. And as soon as they ask us, we're doing no problem there. So.
Okay. Do you have any further questions?
No, Igor, thank you again very much for your work on this.
Igor, thank you very much for the information coming down tonight. Appreciate it.
Okay, thank you very much. So like this girl will say as we're going live. So.
Thank you. Mr. Gagner,
I am good, sir. Thank you.
Okay, we're going to go to comments and concerns. And need I remind everybody to please keep them to 5 minutes and relevant to things that are transpiring presently in the town. And we really don't want to be negotiating or discussing things that happened 15, 20 years ago at all possible. So. Does anybody have a comment or a concern this evening?
Have we ever come up with a list of any the surplus equipment that the different departments have?
I believe we made the request, but we haven't compiled a list.
With your permission, Mr. Chair, we did submit a memo. We did have a handful of departments that supplied us with a listing, but nothing has gone beyond that.
Okay, the deadline was the end of July, so are we going to do anything about it, or?
Well, I think at this point in time, we need to look at the items, and what we actually think the value is to those items, and if we're going to do a reverse auction, or how we're going to go about doing that. So, like I said, not all departments have responded, most, but we need to go through the list and spend some time on it. So, we haven't done that yet. I will look into looking at the list personally myself and seeing where we can go with it, but it would be beneficial to us if all submitted, because we just don't have that much equipment. I mean, we have some things, but not a lot.
Well, what about the senior center? They must have surplus catering or kitchen equipment.
I bet you they do have supplies, but I don't know if they're necessarily going to have a value that's going to be cost-effective to auction. Okay. A lot of kitchen equipment there, the value of it's not a lot.
And the police department, they had a bicycle that was in the foyer. I don't know if that was confiscated, but
I believe there were some bicycles in there. Maybe Mr. Lavash can comment on this. I think some of them had issues with them all.
Had too many that belonged to the police.
No, I don't mean that one. I mean the one that was in the photo that I took right here.
I don't know. It would depend on how long they had it, whether or not they could get rid of it. I don't know. I don't know how long they have to keep it before they can do something with it.
There is a timeline, too. You can't just confiscate something and then turn it into an auction. Right. I can tell you right now, in West Springfield, they've got a line of cars out there that have been sitting there for almost 2 years. They can't auction them yet. So there is a timeline.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Curiosity question. 5 department heads? How many department heads do you have?
I'm sorry?
How many department heads did you notify on the surplus equipment?
Oh. Well,
it went to every board and every committee.
Right. So I don't have the numbers. Sir, but
my question is, who didn't respond so you can't go forward?
I can't tell you exactly who didn't respond. I can find out, but I can't tell you exactly who didn't respond. But I will look into it. Mr. Burrell.
Yes. Thank you. I wasn't going to speak, but I just had a curious question. As you know, at the May town meeting, there was as Beverly had said, there was a citizen's petition to basically video record other meetings. So I now learned for the first time that Igor is giving a cost of $24,000. Now, I've been videotaping meetings and putting them on YouTube that's made available to the citizens of Warren free of charge. So if you can't afford $24,000, I'd be interested in, as a subcontractor, video recording the meetings and putting in a price quote to the town that would be cheaper than that to provide the same service.
Well, I think you take that into consideration. I'll take anything into consideration. It's going to save the town money. And I appreciate the offer. And we will definitely take that into consideration.
Right. And it's not...
If you want to get with Igor and find out what he quoted us and get a copy of this, I'm sure you can look at that.
Well, the issue that I don't understand that makes me awfully confused is the service that I provide is video recording the same meetings. And I had even offered for my free service that I do to supply my video file to WCAT-TV to Igor, and Igor was not interested. So I mean, I could video record this and sell this for $50, but I understand that, you know, that Igor provides DVDs and stuff like that and charges $20. So I tried to work in partnership with him, saying, why don't we share video files?
I think we'd have to work with Igor on that and ask Igor those questions. I think that there's some issues with regards to, you know, what files he can actually utilize from a private citizen, and can he do that? And I mean, Igor is here now. He might want to comment on that, but I don't know. I can't speak on behalf of that. But you might want to answer that question, Igor, if you can use private recordings like that to post onto our cable access channel from a private resident, from a citizen, at no charge.
We operate on the strict guidelines from FCC, and we just do it through the Comcast of the contract we signed. There's no way I'm going to put a selectman meeting or any board meeting, I don't think I'm allowed to do it, on the YouTube or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
So, especially if I don't have a permission, but, I mean, we could check this thing out, legality of that, especially if I don't have permission of some people that want to be on TV or media or for security reasons, whatever it is. If he wants to do it, if he's taping up here, that's whatever he does, that's... But as a representative of a town, I don't think it's for us okay to do it.
We appreciate the offer, Mr. Burrell. We'll look into it. I just want to make sure that we're following all of the rules and regulations of the FCC, and we're not violating anything or people's, you know, rights. So I think we can look into it and take that under consideration and pull the back end on it.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, the other thing, too, is just videotaping, you know, when he videotapes anything or I videotaping, that's actually creating a public record because it is a public meeting. So even if I record it in accordance with the state rules and regulations, my video footage is actually still a public record, even though it was not videoed by him. So I am familiar with the FCC rules and regulations, and there should be no reason why anything couldn't be put on YouTube or anything like that. I mean, I agree with some, you know, a few things with him and other things I don't agree on, but we can save that for a later.
We'll look into it with Igor, and I will trust his opinion on this and move forward, and I appreciate the offer.
Right, thank you.
Anyone else?
All right, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, we'll move on. Correspondence, Mr. Gagner.
The board received a public records request from a resident. The office is in the process of gathering additional information from the requester. In order to provide the proper documents requested.
We will supply that information as soon as we compile everything, and it will be sent out to that person requesting those records.
On October 10th, from 9 a.m. to 12 noon, the town of North Brookfield will hold a regional household hazardous waste day. Warren residents wishing to bring hazardous waste are welcome. Allowable items as well as an associated fee schedule are available in the Board of Selectmen's office. And that will be at the Recycling Center in North Brookfield.
Great. Thank you.
Notification from DEP that in accordance with Governor Baker's Executive Order 562, public listening sessions have been set as part of Mass DEP's thorough assessment of all their regulations. The schedule is available in the Board of Selectmen's office for those interested. The Board of Health has appointed Sydney Plant to the position of Animal Inspector, effective September 24th, 2015.
We have an Animal Inspector. Congratulations. I'm sorry. Hold on 1 second. Brian?
I wanted to jump back to comments and concerns if I could at some point.
Can you let me finish?
Sure, absolutely.
Just this and give me 1 minute, please. Go ahead, Jimmy.
The West Warren Library has requested a one-day liquor license to serve beer and wine as part of a fundraising event. The library will be holding a trivia night on Saturday, October 17th, 2015, from 5 p.m. to 9 p.m.
This is I'll make a motion to approve that license.
I will second that motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. It's an annual event for those. Brian, while he's signing, what's up?
I just had a question.
We're not out of time on that, are we, for healing?
No.
Go ahead, Brian. Quick.
I just had a thing for comments and concerns as a taxpayer. The big elephant in the room is, you know, how we're going to come up with an extra $600,000, okay? I haven't heard anybody talk about it. I haven't heard any ideas. You know what I'm saying?
The $600,000 you're referring to is the school department?
Yeah, where's that going to come out of? All the taxes are going to get split over?
No, we're working on it. We're going to have discussion on the town meeting and the articles coming up next week. I know our department heads, treasurer's accountant, and the assessor's office is working on things. You know, I'll be the first to tell you, I don't want to see the tax rate jump through the roof. I mean, that money was $556 was approved on the town floor. It's a huge
My only comment is, couldn't people come up with loans or something, do something? I haven't even heard an idea. That's all I'm saying. You know, we got treasurer, we got accountant, we got all these people. You know what I'm saying?
Brian, next week, I would say attend the meeting next week because we're going to be inviting everybody in. So I would assume hopefully our treasurer will come in that evening and you'll be able to ask these questions and we should be able to cover a lot of that information at next week's meeting. And if we need to do so, we might schedule a second meeting during the week to cover more if we can't cover it all next week.
I mean, I've
been there next week.
I've been watching this song and dance for 30 years and it's just doing a cycle again.
I hear it. I got it. Been noted, but please attend next week, okay? Because we'll be having a lot of discussions regarding that. So we need to move on next. We have Healink here. And Healink, regarding cultivation here for discussion.
Yes.
We have a bunch of representatives here. And I'm actually going to turn over to Mr. Gagner because he's been pretty much in contact with all of us, with everybody. So if you'd like to come up and have a seat.
Let's go, yeah.
Sure. Feel free. Welcome.
Thank you very much. For the record, my name is Stephen Bookbinder. I'm an attorney with the law firm of Schlesinger and Bookbinder. Office is 1200 Walnut Street, Newton, Massachusetts. With me this evening, and I'll just ask you to raise your hand, Alex Oliphant, who's the Chief Executive Officer, Jim Bonacorsi over here, who's the Chief Financial Officer, Tom Walsh from NetWatch, our security consultant, Marianne Walsh, who's our Governmental Relations Liaison, and my associate, Catherine Adams. HealLink has applied to the Department of Public Health for a license as a registered marijuana dispensary. And in connection with that process, they need to identify a cultivation site, which is what brings us here this evening. We've identified some property on South Street in West Warren, the old mill buildings, as a potential site, and it actually looks like a terrific opportunity. We're here this evening specifically to request a letter from the board, a letter of either support or non-opposition, which is a precondition we need in order to follow through on this process. So let me just tell you a little bit about this company. Alex and Jim came together through a shared belief in the curative properties of medicinal marijuana. They're both longtime friends, they're both successful in their respective businesses, and they've also witnessed both friends and family members who have benefited from medical marijuana as a treatment for various illnesses from other states where it has been legalized. When the DPH reopened the second phase of its application process this spring, Alex and Jim got together, they formed HealLink, and we're going through that licensing process. Another partner of theirs who's not here tonight is Gary Einsidler. Gary is a longtime acquaintance, a former student of Jim's, and Gary is an independent pharmacist and the owner of the Tremont Pharmacy in the south end of Boston. Gary brings his many years of experience running a pharmacy, counseling patients, and dispensing medication to the company, to those in need. HealLink recently retained a national consulting firm, Forefront, to assist with the application process. Forefront has assisted over 60 dispensaries and cultivation sites nationwide in getting their operations up and running. We've also retained NetWatch. I'm going to ask Tom in a few minutes just to say a very few words. With respect to the cultivation site, the product would be grown at the site. It would then be transported to another location for sale to patients, so no sales would occur here. The industry is extremely highly regulated, and there would be extensive security in place. They need somewhere between 20 and 30,000 square feet in order to build out a facility, and they have certain other conditions, all of which could be met if those buildings that we look at today on South Street. As far as the process goes, the DPH has already approved their initial application, and we hope to be submitting the Phase 2 application, which is known as a management and operations profile, within the next few weeks. Once DPH has reviewed that application, they'll hopefully ask us to go along with the next step, which is the site and profile. If all were to go well and they were granted the license, we would hope to come back before you, hopefully maybe late spring, maybe summer, to seek a special permit under your newly enacted bylaw to seek permission for this. So with that, Tom, do you just want to say a couple of words about the security aspect?
Thanks, Steve. Thanks, everyone, for your time. Just give you a quick, brief synopsis of our company, Headwatch. We're a European-based remote video monitoring company. What that means is that we have the ability to put external cameras on buildings so that when somebody walks into a particular area that they shouldn't be in, our detection picks up on it. We react to that with a live audio warning. And that is you two guys in the blacktop, you two guys, whatever it may be, we can give a live video warning, which is a proactive tool to remove people from the site. The next beauty about the product is that we have a direct link to the local chief of police or to the local police station. So your typical idea of alarm monitoring, an internal alarm monitoring system, is that a local police station would get an alarm, but they can't visually verify what it is. We ring the local police authority and we can actually tell them exactly what's happening on the site. We can send them video evidence and photographic evidence of what's happening. So it's visually verified, which they love. We would always do a local presentation to the local chief of police here, which we will do over the course of this application. Our history, obviously, we're a European company. We're 15 years in business. We're 5 years in the US. Our experience over here has been in many verticals, but over the last 2 years we have had a particular focus on this particular vertical. We currently look after, I think it's 4 to 5 cultivation sites throughout Massachusetts, probably I think it's the bones of maybe 13 dispensaries. And throughout the US now, we would consider ourselves the number one security provider within this vertical. With over maybe 30 units that we secure within this area. So we're bringing to a new industry some very kind of in-depth security experience within this industry. So I think
that's you, probably. Thank you, Tom. Do you have any questions for Tom?
No, but I will be sending you Chief Spierkowski's information because he is
going to. I'd love to meet up.
Thank you. And that's really all we had to say, but we're delighted to be here and we appreciate the opportunity.
Well, I've had the opportunity to meet most of you a couple times, the rest of you tonight, and I'm very, very pleased that you like the site, very pleased with what you've proposed, and I would make a motion that we sign that letter of non-opposition.
I would second it, but I just have one question. What is the employment opportunity?
Good question.
Yep. Do you have a sense of how many employees, Alex, that you have that you're employing?
I would say probably about 10 to 15 employees at the cultivation site in the beginning, and then, it can get a lot larger than that.
And I think the reality is, Mr. Lavash, is that just because, things being what they are, the likelihood is we'd be looking for local people to hire. It just makes sense
that's
to have people who live and work here. And in fact, the likelihood is that whoever is going to be, there'll be someone hired to basically be responsible for running that operation. Mm-hmm. That person almost certainly, if they're not here now, mm-hmm. will certainly be moving here, at least for the first couple of years, and set up residence here.
Okay. So I did second.
The motion's been made and seconded. Is there any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. So, just to add to this, I know Jim's been working on this extremely hard. We're very appreciative that you're out here actively looking at Warren. It's something that our community can use, an influx of jobs in some industry. So, we're excited to possibly do business with you and move forward. So, you commented on this that it was late spring, I think I wrote in my notes, that you were seeking the license?
That we would hope to get it, and that's a guess, because, we're really at the mercy of the state. What's happened, though, the first round of applications really went on for several years. Mm-hmm. And when Governor Baker came into office, and Marianne's actually very familiar with this, he really made a commitment to try to speed up the process. So far, what we've seen and felt is that the process is speeding up. But do you want to comment anything else?
Well, they changed it from a procurement model where they were basically applicants were competing against each other to a licensing model. So now, as long as you can check all the boxes of things that are required, they should move you along. And so far, so good.
Great. Any other questions?
No, thank you very much for coming out, and as you know, I'll be in touch.
Appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. It was very nice to meet you. I had spoken to you previously, right?
Yes.
When I called.
Okay.
Thanks. When they said the name again, I was like, wait a minute, I know that.
Nice to meet you as well. Thank,
thank
you.
You.
Thank you.
Yes.
They have a copy, right?
You gave me a copy?
Right. We do.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Alex, thank you for not playing in traffic.
I have to watch
him. I'm just saying.
Could have been.
I was there.
Thank you. Okay, next up we have Mr. Tuttle regarding the town hall basement proposal of options.
Yep, I'm here. Gary's here. This is Larry Tuttle. You know Bob Lavash already?
Yes.
Dario, Nardi, and Jim Gagner.
Sir, how are you?
Arthur Johnson. How you doing? You're
up
for questions.
Yeah. We've been doing work on the two basement,
areas
that need to be addressed.
Mm-hmm.
And the committee has been working on it, and he has done up his information for you people, and I guess basically we're here to see if you have any questions. Some of them have like choices to redo 1, 2, or 3, and that's where we're at.
I guess my question is, I mean, you met, I think you did your town hall remediation committee had a meeting last week, and what was the outcome of the meeting as far as your committee and what you wanted to see? What was the recommendation?
No, I got no.
Oh, yeah.
The gentleman gave us 3 different options of which they were, all of which come up with different prices. I thought you people had copies of the paper. I would have made copies of it.
He does have copies. They do. I
he said he doesn't.
I don't have anything tonight. I had it, but I didn't bring it.
Well, okay. At any rate, we're not going to pay for some of these copies.
Okay. So anyways, there's one for the basement collapse ceiling. And I spoke with Jack Eel and the building inspector before we started. And it brings up another issue that we've got to find out what's going on with the drainage, with the gutters and the pipes. Because he said, before you start to do this, that issue has to be resolved. So on some of the issues, it's doing nothing. A secondary approach would be cleaning up the slabs and penetrating coating and sealing, and the third approach is what was recommended by the committee and by Jack also. He can give you more detail.
So on the third, I'm sorry, so on the third approach, which Jack approved,
agreed with.
That's what we recommended.
Yes, and the committee recommended. So can you elaborate on that a little bit more, sir?
What had happened was that there was a mold remediation project that took place in the basement several years ago, or a few years ago. There is evidence that there is a return of some of the molds into that area. We reviewed the conditions, and there are some organics, some wood partitioning that is still present in the basement, and there is an abundance of moisture in that basement without proper ventilation. The goal that we are looking at, because of the water that comes up through the floor, there's some cracks and other anomalies of the slab, would be to seal that slab so that we would prevent further water coming up from the ground. As Madeline indicated, there was also an issue with the rain leaders and drainage through the building. It was all internalized, and it has deteriorated, and there is actually some open piping so that moisture is allowed to be reintroduced into that area, which is not well ventilated. Previously, the heating system would actually dry out the space because of its inefficiencies. That has been addressed somewhat with a change in fuel, and I believe you're running hot water now and not steam through there.
Not be positive myself.
Okay. Well, there's because of you'd be operating at lower temperatures, you're not producing that abundance of heat to dry out the basement. So the moisture just resides there and contributes to the growth of mold. So we were asked to review the conditions and make recommendations, some of which were just to periodically do your mold remediation, but you'll never solve the problem. The second level of work would be to use a surface applied sealant material that you could get at one of the home improvement stores, and much as you would repair a garage floor at your home. That has limited life cycle and limited performance and doesn't solve some of the problems. And again, we reference the drainage and ventilation. It doesn't address that in any way. The third proposal that was made was to actually grind the surface of the existing slab, removing some of the loose and damaged material, fixing those cracks or penetrations, and then putting an epoxy sealant onto the floor. It's more labor intensive, it's more money, but it does solve that problem and give you some warranty as far as performance for that floor. When I first discussed the project with Jack Keogh, he was asking about, and I believe Robert also had indicated, potentially sealing the walls. And the walls, unfortunately, if you seal one face of that wall, you still have moisture penetrating the wall from the outside, potential freezing because of the, you're not heating the building to the same levels it historically had been heated to. You could get freezing and you could actually cause physical damage to the bricks and so forth in that wall and create a different problem. So I was staying away from sealing the walls and letting that minor amount of moisture just happen as it has been for years, because that'll dissipate, because you have air movement across that wall, you have a less concentrated level of moisture coming in that surface. So the recommendation is to investigate or to document the grinding of the slab. There would be some investigation necessary to survey any hazardous materials that are spills or compounds that are on the floor, but physically abrade the surface so that we can get the proper adhesion and bond of the epoxy. Secondly, and in concert with that, to remedy any of the piping that runs through that basement to make sure that it is properly functioning, that water that is being transported through those pipes is being circulated and dissipated outside. The other item is to introduce mechanical ventilation into the space, which would just be a series of fans to move air around and to have it exit the building. There are some windows along the face of the wall that could be replaced with louvers or through wall units just to exhaust air out of the space.
But there's existing mold in there.
There is existing mold.
You're moving that mold with the ventilation, you'd have to remediate the mold as well,
yes.
Correct?
And it was recommended that the existing cell area, which is a raised floor,
that's the wooden floor,
yeah. That was worked around in under the previous remediation, should have been removed at that point, because it is likely a contributor of some of the mold in the basement right now. But in the mold that is reappearing at some of the floor penetrations, the cracks would be essentially removed and sealed with the abrasion of the floor, plus then the fixing of that crack.
How long are they guaranteeing that to stay before you start to see wear on that?
Well, the beauty of the basement is there's very little traffic down there. Mm-hmm. So you're still getting
moisture underneath, there'll still be
wear
from underneath.
That is why we were promoting the epoxy flooring versus the residential garage floor sealer, in that you have a much stronger bond, a chemical bond, into the abraded concrete, so that it is a commercial grade sealant. So you would get a longer longevity. It is still a additive to a cured concrete floor. So it does have a life cycle, but it's it's a decent number of years.
I think we had a question.
Sorry. If you were going to grind the floor, why wouldn't you just pour a new concrete floor on the top of it?
You would be introducing a porous material on top of a porous material.
Correct, but spending that money on epoxy, which is pretty much chemical hazard, you know, you could pour a new floor, and the new floor would last for 20 years, 30 years.
But to eliminate that hydrostatic pressure through that floor, you would be adding additives of which they are also there's in that same realm as the epoxies.
There's no sump pump type ventilation. There's no...
Not to cover a large area like that.
Okay.
If the existing slab was trenched and you had a network of drainage that you could pull to a certain point, that might be a consideration, but that would be extremely expensive put that in.
Matter question. Run this by, or has anybody contacted the health office about, you know, the issues we've had in the past and the work that's going to be going on down there? If they might have any concerns regarding what we're moving forward with or potentially moving forward with?
No, I haven't talked to the board now.
Do you think we should? Reach out to them and find out. I mean, they may have some concerns. I'd like to make sure that the health office is on board with.
Well, this is just telling you what's available.
Right.
What we're recommending.
Correct.
Not that we're doing it right now.
But I'd like to hear, you know, if correct. They have a concern regarding
what
we're going to be doing down there.
I will have Kenny come see you.
So the cost on option 3, is it?
$16,000.
That was the actual ceiling. There were prior costs for the survey, for equipment rental, and that does not address mechanicals or the fixing of the drainage. That's just the slab treatment. And part of, you know, sort of putting Madeline in an awkward spot, the narratives or reports that we made had three tiers of value, because what wasn't expressed to us as to availability of funds and support of the town to pursue any or all of these. And as such, we were contracted to provide the information and the options that we thought most suitable, but we would be waiting for the directive from the town to produce the documentation for final pricing on it. So These are estimates.
I understand. I mean, Madeline and her committee, Mr. Lavash included, has worked extremely hard on maintaining, you know, cost and trying to find funding to do what repairs they can do on the town hall. And I know we're looking at sponsoring an article, Madeline, moving forward this fall.
Yeah.
And you had originally two transfers, I think it was, and some money coming out of historical.
That is for the work over the police door.
Okay.
That's already a separate issue. But the $8,009, the one transfer, has to do with the police store.
Okay. $17,000.
The other problem is, above all this, we still have to get into the gutters and the drainage, which Jack is recommending before we even do this, because it's not going to cure the problem if we keep the water coming into the cellar.
Let's get some numbers on
that's what we need to do.
Because
then we also got the report on the crawl space. So we did the basement in two sections.
And the crawl space, as a summary, had some remedial work done. I believe it was a recommendation from Reinhardt Associates out of Springfield that looked at the building and made some recommendations some years ago. What they discovered, and it was easily observed, is the floor framing there was very typical for the period of the building, a notched floor joist. So the floor joists in that crawl space for the room above are actually a 12-inch floor joist, which has a very substantial load-carrying capacity, and that was a small meeting space historically in the building. The notching of that reduced that 12-inch dimension to 8 inches. 2x8 is what you would have in a bedroom in a house, not a meeting room. So the quick remedial effort that was recommended and executed was to put a beam running at the bearing point of the notch, running the length of the crawl space, and then positioning columns underneath that beam to basically give you that 12-inch floor joist capacity. Right now, the steel posts supporting that beam, those columns, are in direct contact with the dirt floor of the crawl space and have, because again, the moisture, deteriorated. They are rusting, and so they are, in some cases, showing not failure, but not far from failure. So what you're reverting to is the original design capacity of that floor, the 2x8s. So the big question is, and what is in the report, is that room, what is the loading capacity of that room? What is that intent? Right now, there's some storage in there. Storage would have a similar loading capacity as an assembly space. So it would be recommended to still try to obtain that loading capacity of a floor with 2x12s. So we can either replace the steel columns and remove any contact from soil, so build up masonry piers and put steel columns on that, supporting that beam again, and that's one solution. Another solution is to put hangers at the individual joists, and that is the recommendation that we're making that makes the columns and the redundant beam and so forth obsolete, and they can just be removed.
How long ago was that beam installed? Do you know, Metal?
It would have been a product of I'm going to say back in the 80s.
Yeah.
Only because we were also vied for the survey of the building with my first late 80s.
Yeah. In speaking with Jack also, agreed that the joist tank would be appropriate because my impression is that's
hangers.
Just the hang.
Okay.
Yeah, the hang, not doing the long column. That it's just a weight room for the police.
Yeah, it's an exercise
room. So it's not that you're going to be having meetings in there.
Right.
Unless you people feel.
But what if that happened? What if that change happened? What would we have to do?
Right. But I mean, if you're talking, then if you think in the near future you're going to be having meetings down there, then maybe we don't want to go that route.
Okay.
Yeah, but he's saying we'd almost put it back to where it should be for the meeting.
Yes, as soon as you put the hangers in, you would be netting the entire loading capacity of the 2x12 floor, so that the storage and or meeting
and the meeting will be fit once we put the hangers in.
Okay.
And that's what was being achieved originally with the beam and the multiple steel columns.
Okay. So
that was what was recommended, and then, again, ventilation in that space. There are some windows that are letting air just move freely, and we thought for security purposes to change those out for louvers and introduce some mechanical ventilation as well, because there are some mechanicals that have been introduced to that area that exasperate the moisture levels.
That's one of my only concern with security purposes and entering, installing louvers and security of the building.
The air conditioners, that's what
he's
talking about. Dispatch air conditioner, I don't know when those went in, but that's what's bringing the moisture in under there.
Okay.
That's what the air conditioner upstairs is, it's in that crawl space.
That condensate is allowed to just go out onto the soil.
That's what we were here for. Give you the information and...
We have questions, sir?
I'd like to make a comment. If we could go back to the concrete slab in the basement. There's another option, and I think this gentleman over here brought it up, with pouring a new slab down there. In the building code, you're required to put poly under that floor, under the slab, and that application works really well. If you look at an old slab that doesn't have that, it'll condense in the summertime, and modern slabs that have that poly, they don't. And if you wanted to go one step further, you could put a thermal break in there with some foam board and create an even further barrier between the moisture and the new slab. I would be concerned with the epoxy trying to seal over cracks and hoping that the cracks don't spread or...
Well, in the process of the correction work, the cracks are filled with hydro-mixed cement, so that it's expanding cement.
As long as the rest of the...
And there isn't evidence of recent movement or settlement, so that we felt pretty confident that that was a less obtrusive method, because what you've described would be fine, but you'd be losing headroom within the basement, because you have to have minimum thicknesses for those systems to actually be installed and performed. The other item that I don't want to make this sound like it's you do this and you never have to worry again, because the present boiler is located in a large depression in that area, a pit, which has a sump pump. Every change in plane that you can't seal is a weak link, so that it is not free from moisture, but it is all that is also the sole collection point in the basement for any of the moisture, and it does have an existing sump that is operational, so that would be maintained. So it's not that you're going to have a bone dry, put all your best records, town records, into that basement. You're going to have a basement, and it's just going to be drier, and you won't have the mold developing as it has been.
Okay. Anything else, Mr. Lavash?
No, I think I'm pretty well set.
No.
Okay. I am good, sir.
Okay. Well, thank you for coming in. I will look at the documents. I apologize I didn't have to bring them tonight. Did I have your copy, sir?
Yeah.
I appreciate that.
They don't have some of Madeline's notes, though, from some of the conversations
that
we've had.
Notes, I'm sure. Thank you. Thank you for coming in. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Okay, next. Mr. McLaughlin from Triple M Homes regarding rent control discussion. Sir. Kurt Malin, Mr. Malin, regarding net metering for discussion. Hello, Kurt. How are you?
How are you?
Good, thanks. Long time no see.
Yeah, thanks for inviting me back. It's been a while. Well, as I discussed with Mr. Nardi before, my understanding is the town is potentially has an appetite to take up to 500,000 kilowatt hours of net metering credits, and I so happen to have one site remaining in my portfolio in Great Barrington, which is in the same load zone as Warren, which has net metering credits. It's in the program. It's been net metering assured, if you will. So we're not waiting on any pending legislation, and it'll produce, close to 1 million kilowatt hours. So we have ample appetite to supply the town of Warren, and we'd love to do it. It's a good fit for us. Finding municipal off-takers is the ideal. We have other private off-takers that we could sell to, but it's better for us to go municipal from the creditworthy off-take standpoint. So that's really it. We'd love to work with you guys on it. I know I came here before.
So let me just bring everybody up to speed on kind of where we're at. I mean, our board met, I think it was back late spring, early summer. We had actually had Mr. Malin in. We had Mr. Sarno in from Borrego, and we had a couple of net metering offerings, one for the landfill. The landfill at this point in time, in correspondence with Mr. Sarno, there really isn't credits available to us at this point in time, and I'm concerned that we won't be able to take advantage of it if these credits are used up by other municipalities and we don't take advantage of what's there now, because they're going away. And they're kind of time sensitive, and we want to bring something before the fall. So we were set to go with the offer that we had in the landfill, and that since has not happened, so we're entertaining other offers. Mr. Malin was in, we had a gentleman in from Seaboard Solar last week regarding that, and they both presented us with two offers. I guess a question I have for you, Kurt, is the document you sent me today regarding the cap, having your space underneath this cap, and,
right.
and you're here.
Right.
So the facility that you're referring to that we would net meter off of is where again?
It's in Great Barrington. We call it, it's a fairground solar, I and call it. It's a five. It's a 650 kW DC project.
And how soon would we be able to net meter off of that?
You know, it's I mean, in my world, we have to be done and up and running by the end of 2016 because of the federal tax credit. But the goal on this project is, for various reasons, we can't have it done before January 1st of this year, but soon after, we'd like to see it up and running. So we'd love to start construction in like November, December.
But if we, once we move, bring this before the town and we have, and it's approved, let's say, and we commit to this project, so we would be probably looking at the end of next year before we can net meter?
No, it would either be right at the beginning of the year or, you know, from a construction standpoint, sometime in the spring.
And the facility that you're working on presently, Mr. Tarsiak, on Spring Street, those credits are gone, correct?
Those credits are gone, yeah.
Originally the offer was through Spring Street that we were looking at.
I believe so. Yeah. We were going to go half to you guys and then half to community. So because they were both community sites.
Okay.
They're not. You know, the thing is about this. There's not. I don't. I mean, there's not that many projects out there that have these things available.
Correct. And I don't want our town to lose out.
Yeah.
So.
I mean, we've. You know, to be perfectly blunt, we've been working with another town that's been dragging their heels. We're not committed. We haven't bid officially, but. They've been taking 6 months, and I keep telling them the same thing. And they're about a month behind you guys now. So if
well, our timeline right now, and what I'd like the board to consider is to consider this this week, and then next Tuesday to vote on the offer that we're going to accept and bring before the town on November 5th. So
perfect.
That's kind of the timeline that I'm looking at right now. If the board's okay with it, if Jim or Mr. Lavash, do you have any questions for?
Yeah, do we have a price readout on his own?
I have my. We
started working and we got in our first project about 2 years ago. We committed to, I think it was East Longmeadow. We had a large site in hand and we basically felt we went with like the market rate of 20% discount with a 9-cent floor, and we tried to stick to that. We have stuck to that with every single municipality, and that's, you know, Belchertown, Hamden-Wilbraham Schools, Great Barrington, Sheffield, Southern Berkshire School District. We've done the same exact deal with every town and every school district we've ever dealt with, and the theory is we felt it was inappropriate to kind of negotiate and leverage municipalities and school districts against each other. We wanted to be consistent. So I even asked my superiors at Altus today whether there was room for me to move down, and they said that's what they do is 20% discount, 9-cent floor, and hopefully that's good enough. The difference in a 500,000 kilowatt hour need is between 20% and 25% is a couple grand a year. It's not a huge amount. And maybe there's a trade-off in terms of, you know, we're an absolute certainty. We have everything
that's,
we need.
That's my one concern is I want the certainty.
Yeah.
You know, people can come in here and offer us a better option possibly, but
right.
if there's no credits there and you can't guarantee it, we're out.
Right.
So I want the certainty that it's there.
No, and I developed this project personally. It actually, there were two megawatts in net metering credits left when this one got in. This was my last one.
We also know you're invested on Spring Street, so we know where to find you.
Yeah, we're here. You know where to find us. I think it would be a good fit, but, you know, we'll see next week.
Any other questions?
No, I just want to see the numbers.
I can. Well, I will make copies for my board off of a copy that I have. I'll supply it to him, Kurt, after the meeting's over. So we're looking to potentially vote next week.
Okay.
So you should be hearing from us the Wednesday following, which would be, I think, the 6th.
Perfect.
We'll move to vote on that next week.
Great.
So I appreciate you coming down.
No,
I appreciate
you
emailing the information, and we'll be in contact next week.
Thanks a lot. I appreciate it.
Thanks. Clark, regarding Palmer Motorsports discussion.
Yeah,
sir?
I'd like to.
Good evening.
I'd like to file a formal complaint with the board about the noise of the racetrack. This is just a small sampling of names that I took. It took me less than a half an hour driving down my road to get those names. And that is a permit from the town of Palmer for the raceway, and at this point the raceway isn't even up to They're running three or four cars, and it sounds like the Daytona 500 in my backyard. I'm not in a butter. I'm like 50 feet from being in a butter. And me and everybody up and down the road are affected by it. It's just, it's unbearable. It's ruined our quality of life. We had a nice, quiet neighborhood, and now it's ruined. Every weekend, you never know whether it's going to be during the week. It could be a Monday, it could be a Tuesday. August 28th and 29th was horrendous. Labor Day, they ran motorcycles up there. It was so loud, you could close the doors and turn the air conditioner on, and you could still hear it inside the house. If Palmer was dumping their trash in the morning, somebody would be all upset about it.
These are for us, sir.
You can have them.
Please put those in a file.
Thank you. I come to the board and ask them for some help.
Okay. I've researched this somewhat regarding noise complaints. I don't know. Have you gone before our Board of Health office regarding noise pollution complaints?
And they're limited in their control.
They are.
And we're going to the DEP. Talk to Catherine in Springfield. And they're limited too. They're working on noise studies. I haven't seen anybody in my backyard doing a noise study, so.
I mean, I understand. The noise study is obviously going to be a cost if our town has to perform it. I mean, I spoke to our Board of Health chairman regarding this and where we're at this point in time. And he informed me that he had had a discussion with the Palmer Board of Health back this summer. Hasn't heard from them since then, but that their offices are working on some complaints, obviously, from their residents.
There's more than, yes, there's residents in Ware, there's residents in Warren, there's residents in Palmer. This weekend, the 4th, there is a meeting in Ware, and Ann Gobi and Todd Simola will be there to listen to our concerns.
That's this weekend?
Yep.
October 4th, 4 o'clock. At the, what club is it?
Gabe's.
Gabe's?
All right. Right there on Gabe's.
And that's as far as I know. And then October 5th, Palmer is having a noise meeting. They finally announced it today. I called this morning and they didn't have it announced, but now they've announced it this afternoon.
At the police station.
Right. It will be at the police station, October 5th. And I believe it's at 7 o'clock, but I'm not sure. And they've done supposedly noise studies, but if you look at that permit, I'm listening to 3-4 cars up there with open-ended headers, and it sounds like the Daytona 500. If they're gonna give them 40 cars and 1,000 people, that's going to be outrageous. I'm sorry. I built that house there 18 years ago because of the solitude and the quiet. I didn't build it to listen to a racetrack.
Well, gladly, I can attend the meetings regarding this. You know, I know DEP is involved. I know conservationists had some wetlands issues up there. The Attorney General's office has been working on things. I think there's been some fines levied in regards to wetlands.
There's been some huge fines levied by the sounds of it.
And I know that
but
there's things that are still working.
It seems like they can just do whatever they want to do.
And keep in mind, it is our neighbor. It is in Palmer. It's not in our boundaries. I mean, I will gladly go and support and help to the best of my ability. I mean, I can be there and help with that cause. And, you know, it was Senator Gobi and Simola and Todd Simola showing, you know, support. I think it's important. I don't know how strong our word would be, you know, as a board moving there. I mean, it is Palmer. It is, they in 2007 went through the hearings and the processes to get this approved. But, you know, I don't want to see our residents suffer either. So, I'm willing to offer whatever help we can. But I also have to make sure to keep within the guidelines of what our town laws are regarding the health department and conservation and that. So, you know, we can't step in with noise pollution, you know, findings and not go to the Board of Health office with it. And I assure you, our Board
and
of Health
I
is working.
And I am going to say that I am, and many people on that road are suffering a quality of life issue because of it.
So coming here tonight and giving us these dates or and presenting them to the board, I'm going to make every effort to make both of those meetings myself. If my board is able to make it, we will post the meeting in case other members of the board can make the meeting and show our support. I'm glad to do that. I'm sure my board would be in favor of that too. So if,
thank you very much.
That's something we can offer support and try to help.
Yes.
And have a voice.
Right.
So.
I don't understand how they can just. It's a little sliver of Palmer that's tucked in between two other towns, and they can just get away with it.
Well, they found the right spot, you know. And
well, and now I don't want to get all, but Todd Samuel is all up against this racetrack in Charlton. He does not want to have a racetrack in Charlton.
Well, if he's there that evening, I think we can ask him those questions.
I guess
we can answer
him
now. He's not here, but we can ask those questions of Mr. Samuel at that point in time. So, I mean, just to make sure I have this correct, the 4th is at 4 p.m. at Gabe's and where?
I believe so. This is my understanding.
And then there's the October 5th at the Palmer Police Station?
Correct.
Do you have a time on that?
I'm not sure what the time
is.
I'm not exactly sure, but I believe it's 7. I'm not exactly sure.
Mr. Chairman.
I just found out about that this afternoon.
Yeah, well, we can ask Loretta, maybe you can verify that, those times for us and share them with us. I'm pretty sure I can make both.
That would be great.
At least one, but I'm pretty sure I can make both. So, and if any of our board members are there, we'll definitely post to make sure that we're.
I mean, they're gonna talk noise mitigation. I want noise elimination. You know, I'm sorry.
Right.
It's not tolerable.
We'll show our support first to start and get out there and have a voice. So I appreciate you bringing this to us. We want to make sure we're hearing all your concerns. We want to make sure we're doing this the right way. I apologize it's taking so long. It seems like it takes forever to get an answer.
Yeah.
And to move on these things.
Again, I'm saying this is a very small sampling. It took me maybe an hour to get that many signatures.
So if
I went down and started knocking on doors, I'm sure we could have hundreds of people.
Okay.
You know.
Anything else? Anybody else would like to add? Mr. Brown, any question?
The only thing I would like to add is you and I are actually familiar with something. Is there was an issue that I had done a public records request, and I might have provided you the information. Is back initially when the town of Palmer had public hearings at the town, there were certified letters that were sent to the Warren Board of Selectmen and the Planning Board. And I have the letters and the green signature cards that I got through a public records request, and nobody from the town of Warren ever responded to attend any of the meetings. And never even notified the public either.
Okay, I can't speak for the planning board.
Well, I can because I have the records.
I don't know if we actually. I've never seen those documents. At the time,
my mother-in-law was in the butter, but she was dying. She was failing in health, and both me and my wife have had health problems in the past few years, so we haven't been able to be up on everything. And all of a sudden, boom, it's in our backyard. You know.
So I guess what I'm saying is part of the responsibility goes back on the Board of Selectmen and the Planning Board for not attending those public hearings. Because according to my conversation, the documents I have from the Town of Palmer Planning Board and the Conservation Commission was exactly what I just said. Mm-hmm. Nobody from the Town of Warren ever showed up, ever notified me, never did nothing. So the town was definitely notified to notify the citizens, and they did not do that.
So when that happened, prior to my arrival,
correct, right, and I agree. That's nothing to do with the three of you.
I am showing my support now, and I will gladly attend the meetings moving forward. I can't change the past.
No, I understand. I understand.
So I
just want to just state it. That's all.
And try to show my support and have a voice to help out with this.
No, I understand.
And that's my responsibility as a selectman.
Absolutely.
I won't speak for other boards.
No, I understand.
But for this board, I can do that as chair. And
yes.
If our other members want to attend, they can attend also.
Yes. Yeah. Thank you.
So, thank you.
You're welcome.
Is there any further questions? Any other questions? No. So Lorena, we'll look into those dates, and if any of our board members want to attend, we'll post so that we're okay with that.
Thank you very much.
Questions, sir?
I just wanted to say that we've got a 70-acre parcel that abuts our property, 491. They are now clear-cutting that, so I expect that property to probably end up with a racetrack.
I think that abuts the racetrack.
It abuts the racetrack on the.
And then again, that
on the swamp side that we've had all the wash-away problems coming from.
So they're working in there now, right?
They're clear-cutting.
Oh, yeah.
They're clear-cutting.
But again, that's a noise barrier we're losing on top of already what we don't have. It's just devastating that whole lot.
When the leaves fall off that hill, it's Colonel's Mountain.
That's a Connecticut landowner. He doesn't care.
When that leaves fall off that hill, that's just a solid granite rock up there. It's like a big echo chamber.
Hmm. I understand. Okay. Thank you for coming in tonight, folks.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Number 11. Contract amendment number 3 for town and art engineering. Additional engineering costs associated with the Pleasant Street Improvement Project, Phase 2 funding through the FY14 Warren CDF 1
Give
grant.
Give me a second way in.
We're going to wait for approval and vote for the chair to sign this. This is additional monies needed for engineering for Pleasant Street from FY14. It's not the money that we allocated for FY15 that was voted on a few weeks ago. So I will await a motion.
So moved.
Absolutely.
Motion been made and seconded. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Sure. Aye.
Aye. Me?
Yep.
3?
Okay.
Yes, please.
Do you want it? You want any of this?
Treasury warrants and invoices.
Yep, Mr. Chair, I'll make a motion that we warrant number 39 for $38,822.96 and warrant number 41 for $863,353.89 and warrant 40 for $531.57, all dated 9/29.
I'll second. Well, we can't really do 40 because Bob has to abstain.
All right, so I'll do 39 and 41. 9/29/15.
Yes, Mr. Lavash, second.
I'll second.
Okay. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
One abstention. With one abstention. No. And then 39 and 41. I will make a motion that we pay warrant number 40 in the amount of $531.57. Second.
I will second that.
Motion been made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. One abstention. Mr. Lavash.
I'll make a motion. Approve warrant number 42 in the amount of $1,450 even.
Second? All in favor?
Aye.
One abstention.
All right, the drawdown fiscal year 14, invoice number 3, Pleasant Street Improvements, grant 12-740.1. Pay is Pioppi Construction in the amount of $115,345.43.
Second. Motion been made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. While we're signing, new business is up next. Mr. Lavash, you have anything?
No.
Sure. Gagner,
do
you have any new business?
I do. An article was brought to my attention that Holyoke Community College was looking at opening up a satellite campus in Ware, to which I immediately reached out to Holyoke Community College and found out that that was not what they were looking at. They were looking at something totally different. However, through the conversations, I was able to get a meeting with Holyoke Community College for the 7th, I will be meeting with them, just talking about what their future plans are, introducing Warren and what we have to offer to see if there are any future things that we could get going together. That's what I got.
Well, that's pretty exciting. It would be nice if that happened. We appreciate your work on these different ventures that we have going on.
Just another conversation.
Sorry. Beverly?
I have a question. Has the board requested police presence at the meetings now?
Tonight? No.
Well, last week.
There hasn't been a request from our board. The chief has allowed that to happen on his own doing, but we haven't requested police presence at all. I should say, I have not. I'm not sure if Mr. Lavash or Mr. Gagner has, but I have not.
So they're on duty when they come here.
Correct.
I had requested an officer here last week.
Okay. And this week?
I did not request an officer here this week, but if he showed up on his own accord, I thank him for being here.
But he's getting paid, right?
He is.
But we did not request him, and I don't think Mr. Lavash did. No. I only have one other thing to add on new business. We're going to be having article discussion next week. So we're hoping a memo went out regarding that and having the boards come in to go over what we have coming forward at the town meeting. Mr. Corral had mentioned that tonight, that, you know, he had some questions about that. So any residents that are concerned about the articles and what we're going to do, we're hoping to answer those questions next week at that time. There's no further business. Our next meeting is scheduled for October 6th, 2017 at 7 p.m. We're actually posted tomorrow night too, Mr. Gagner, because we'll be attending planning. So we are posted tomorrow night, Bob, if you want to attend the planning board. So the next scheduled meeting is at 7 p.m. On October 6th. With that being said, I'll
motion
to
motion to adjourn.
Second. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
I won't forget my bag. That'll be good.